Hello and welcome to episode 6 of Subplot of Course, a podcast discussing a new science fiction literary work every month by casual fans just like you. I'm Stavros, and with me is someone who's looking into the reintroduction of high school math via portable video games, Charlie.
Wait, Charlie? When did that happen?
All right, and also with me is Vincent. Vincent is a doctor looking into the benefits of grafting laser gun arms on everyone in the Northern Hemisphere.
I mean, that's definitely a major plus. I think health insurance companies would totally go for it.
I agree. And finally, we're also joined by John, an engineer who designed the extremely important exhaust port on the newest class Mecha.
Did you just call it
totally
Mecha?
True.
Wait,
totally
did true. You just call it Mecha or is it Mecha?
I did. We'll get into that.
Oh, we're already into like pronunciation problems.
Yes, we're already getting there. So anyway, so we'll get to the pronunciation stuff. But so for this episode 6, we're talking about United States of Japan, written by Peter Tyrius. I apologize if I'm butchering that. I'm sure I am. Published in 2016. So let's talk about the plot a little bit first. So United States of Japan is an alternate World War II history novel set in the 80s after Nazi Germany and the Empire of Japan's victory over the Allies. Plot centers around Beniku Ishimura, the half-Japanese child of parents that were interned by the U.S. during the war. He now works as a video game censor for the Japanese government on the West Coast. And also they're a giant robot, which is everyone's probably a favorite component of this book. So let's jump right in with the first topic, which is tech. I definitely feel like this is one of the main hooks. It's set in the 80s, but there's tons of, even though it's set in the 80s, you know, due to the alternate history, there's a lot of advanced tech stuff. Let's talk about the mechs first, or Mecha. So, you know, we're talking about pronunciation. I listened to an audiobook. They called it Mechas. How did you guys interpret this?
Mechanicals become mechs. Mechanicals become mech?
Sounds reasonable to me.
I have never heard it pronounced as Mechas before.
Yeah. I think, Stavros, you should coin that term.
Mechas?
Yeah, Mechas.
I'm going.
You betcha. They're Mechas.
Exactly.
I'm like, Mechas, my favorite genre of anime.
Yes. So let's talk about these guys a little bit. So basically, you know, they're giant robots that patrol around the West Coast in the Japanese-controlled area of the USJ. I feel like they don't even really show up that much. They kind of just show up to be introduced as, holy shit, they're giant mechs, and then at the giant mech battle at the end of the book. It's definitely on the cover art. It's definitely a huge part of this book. How do you guys feel about it?
I feel like it's, for me, I liked the fact that it happened the way you just described it, that you expect tons of mechas, and there are very few mechas, but there's a ton of other tech that kind of pops up. But to me, it was also like having a Bruce Willis on the cover of a movie, only to find out that he was like the butler for like 5 minutes. And then you're like, wait, I thought I came in expecting mechas and Bruce Willis, and I got some other guy named Ben. Like, what's going on? And am I reading the wrong book? I think that actually, you know, after the first 100 pages where I realized I was not getting what I wanted, I was actually pleasantly surprised, because I felt that like a typical fan fiction or kind of like, you know, anime kind of book would just be very two-dimensional. Shows you a picture of mech, it's going to be mechs. Shows you a picture of scandi-clad women, they're going to be everywhere. Like, this one throws you for a curveball, and I liked it.
Yeah, I thought it was kind of like a, you know, world-building type stuff. It's like, look at all the cool stuff they have, more so than, like, this is what you're going to be reading about the whole time.
So it's not just a book about giant mechs. It's like, there's mechs is a sometimes plot device, not an always plot device.
Yeah.
A lot of biology tech. There's a lot of gun tech. There's a lot of really weird kind of wartime kind of tech. And a lot of stuff which is just kind of 80s. Like part of me thought that, like, whoa, this is way too advanced for the 80s. And then sometimes I think, oh, no, we're totally back in the 80s. Like, it's a very interesting kind of dichotomy where it's like, the internet is super crazy good. And then it's like, well, like, I think, Stavros, you mentioned, it's like, well, if the Japanese did take over for about, like, you know, 40 years, maybe internet would have come out a lot faster, because like we're so like America Online versus Japanese tech. Maybe you would have internet fast.
That's a good point. Yeah. What do you think, John, as the engineer, what's your perspective on giant robots
on mechas.
Yeah.
I think the mechas came out. They were alluded to at the beginning of the book. They didn't really make a splash until about, I think, literally halfway through the book. To some extent, the tech, that part of the tech story is it's not really a plot device. You're laughing because you know that, like, I find it completely unreasonable as an engineer that's high technology. But I thought, to sort of, for instance, actually, to be honest, that a lot of the other tech was more upfront. Like, they were talking about the internet and porticles and basically advanced computing devices, all kinds of medical advances. You know, that was pretty good from a sci-fi standpoint. A lot of it was, like, really weaponized and gruesome. So, but for, as a plot device in a sci-fi book, he had plenty of technology in here, advanced technology. Do we think that the Japanese, after winning the war, would have advanced? I guess, because the technology level in the book, at least including the mechas, but probably not including the mechas, is basically well beyond our current technology. So do we really think that Imperial Japan would have been capable of tech advancement 50 years ahead, I guess?
No, like World War II in the 40s, and then now it's like, it's like full on 80 years later, and we're not caught up to this book yet.
Yeah. So
it's pretty effective, whatever they're taking.
Let me just cut in for a second. I feel like the author's kind of going for somewhere between, like, hey, this might have happened versus like, I've watched a lot of anime and feel like I want to create a world where there's lots of crazy anime stuff. He's not going for, like, complete realism here. He's also going, like, also there are robots.
Yeah, I think there's the one part where they're talking about the medical technology, and it's just like, look at all the crazy stuff we have when we have no morals and can experiment on tens of thousands of people.
Yeah, that's definitely, like, the serious versus, like, the crazy anime component.
Yeah.
Well, there are both of those things happening there.
It's a very weird kind of social technology mix. Like, a lot of the tech they present are very morally and ethically kind of, like, very bankrupt. And it's this weird thing where you kind of feel like, would the Germans and the Japanese have been that morally bankrupt and been, like, super proponents of a lot of this tech? Or is that some of it, like, us projecting as Americans onto, like, the enemy that, oh yes, they would have burned the Jews, they would have, like, slaughtered the Chinese, they would have done all this type of stuff. So they, of course, they would have done all this terrible stuff.
They were well on their way.
I think there was, though. I mean, it was mentioned a little bit earlier, but I think there is sort of a helping of negativity with each of the technologies introduced in the book have sort of a, I don't know, an antithesis to them, because the mechas cause radiation damage to their pilots. All the nuclear weapons that were used caused sterility in the population that remained, in the United States. And even the advanced computing technologies, which, are ubiquitous and allow them to have all this technology and gaming, it really also leads to, like, massive censorship, no privacy, a police state.
So, I was going to say, it seems like the networking capabilities are almost like, we pushed it this fast so that we can monitor everyone all the time. Yay.
Good points. All right, so let's jump to a slightly different topic here. Let's talk about the main character, Biniko. So this is the second book that we've read where the main character turns into Elite Haxor by the end of the book. Like, he's just, like, this guy. Turns out he's designed this subversive video game. But personally, I found him to be super unlikable through most of this book. Like, he's kind of like, wham, I'm here and I don't want to do anything.
Wait, didn't I thought the what's his name? Matsuraga. I need to look it up to get all the syllables.
Don't say random Japanese names. It's tempting, but don't say random Japanese names.
Unless it's not clear, none of us are Japanese.
Totsugawa!
No, well, there you go. But I thought that the daughter made the subversive game, but he helped design the original game.
Right. He's involved in the process, at least. But, like, we're dealing with this character who, I mean, he has, like, a mildly heroic death at the end, I guess, getting shot in the face, in the chest by a mech. But, how do you guys feel about him in general?
Unlike the other book where the guy ended up a lead hacksaw, like, this guy went to, like, military school. Like, he kind of purposely stayed under the radar and partied and stuff like that. But he's just, like, it came easy to him. Like, I'm fine with that. That's kind of legitimately how some people turn out and stuff like that.
I feel that the character of Ben kind of illustrates one, not a major problem I have with the book, but like a kind of a minor problem that adds up over time with the book. Whenever I read kind of sci-fi, I always expect a leap of faith, right? You know, there's going to be something that you can't explain. You just have to go with it and it's totally fine. And I'm totally fine with tech leap of faiths. I'm totally fine with history leap of faiths. But sometimes plot hole and individual interaction leap of faiths, I feel a lot more cringy when those happen. And it's only mediocre, but it's like this guy is not just a programmer. He's also got to be a statistician because this video game of his predicts exactly how the war is going to end out. And based off those simulations, that's how they won the war, the Japanese versus the Americans. And then his USA game is supposed to predict exactly how the United States is supposed to fight back against Japan and win the war. So it's like, how does one guy program all of that, but somehow go under the radar and have one other guy suddenly take advantage for all his work? Like, if I even gave you my science homework back in high school, Star Wars, to copy, not to say that you did, but maybe you did, I don't think you would even remember, like, question number 5 if someone asked you, you did a great job on this homework, Star Wars. How did you get the answer in question number 5 about the boat leaving at 5 o'clock and the other boat leaving at 6 o'clock? It's like, oh, I don't know. Like, how does someone, like, get all the credit for that? It's like those jump leaps of faith to me that I'm like, I'll go with it, but when they keep adding up, it kind of adds up, and I kind of like, oh, like, I wish the plot were tighter.
I thought that was fine. I figure in any piece of fiction, it's almost always like, oh, a hero character is going to be doing way more than a single person does. So, just like the fact that you are reading fiction almost necessitates that kind of leap of faith plot-wise, and I thought that this one, like, worked, despite, yeah, in the real world, it probably wouldn't be that possible. But there, you know, it's not like things relative to this don't happen in the real world.
Yeah, certainly there's got to be some license here to create, you know, he's only got 400 pages to move the story along here. Unless this is volume one of something. Vince, is your criticism sort of, or your, you know, was the magic broken for you because Musaraga essentially got too much credit? There's no way he could have really pulled it off.
There's a bunch of like small things like that where, like, you know, Akiko, like, you know, super blindly following the emperor, but her brother got like killed and she feels like no remorse and stuff like that. I would be like, but then she suddenly discusses it all at the end. I'm like sometimes I'm kind of like these weird kind of inconsistencies to me, like in terms of personality or credit sharing and stuff like that. To me, they're not hard to write in. They're like how about we just make him the lead designer on a team of 10? I'd be like, okay, totally. That's totally fine. And then, like, now he made USA with a different team of 10. Okay, totally fine. I'll roll with it. But sometimes he seems too
elite. How do you understand how elite he is? I think
he's so crazy. And he's the only hacker. Like, everyone's like, oh my God, he's in my portal. How'd he do it? It's like, is he seriously the only Japanese guy who can hack other people's portals? Like, that is amazing.
He's like the head of the department that does that.
Video game censorship, not hacking people's portals.
They gave him sort of this superpower. I mean, he is the let's not forget, he is the main character of the book. Yeah. You know, God forbid the author try to give him some unique ability. But I mean, I think that there might have been a little bit of, maybe it's hand waving, but me, in my mind, it's explained away as the Japanese bureaucracy is so out of control and so inflated that essentially a person like Musaraga could get away with taking credit without much pushback for his underlings' work. Because to some extent, that's, you know, a lot of the bureaucracy, a lot of the folks in the management, the generals, are taking credit for the good work of people below them. So I think that's kind of explained in there. There's a whole chapter on complaints about bureaucracy, I think.
Yeah,
that's how I formed it in my mind.
I don't want to harp on it. It's a very small thing, but like to me, it just kind of adds up after I see like a few of them jump out.
Yeah, it's like they even go on about how the very bureaucracy that's supposed to prevent this stuff from happening basically enables this type of stuff with people taking credit or like, you know, essentially completely screwing up, but just like everyone saying like, that was the right thing because then nobody loses face and stuff like that.
Part of me wonders in a meta way, you know, Peter, he works, I think, at Sony or some other kind of video game kind of companies. I wonder if he's kind of like, I really wish I had these powers. Like, someone's taking all the credit for my video games, and I really want to stick it right back at them, and I'm going to be able to hack all their stuff and then get back at them.
We're talking about this already. Let's jump to the culture question. So, you know, you know, of course, you know, this book is in the USJ, which is the Japanese controlled portion of the country. Do you guys feel that what is portrayed in the book would be an accurate extrapolation of what the Empire of Japan's culture was in the 40s from what we know of it?
I did like the fact that it focused so much on, like, emperor worship, because it seems like, I mean, that's, oh, no, I don't know what I'm saying.
I know. It's this fine line between sounding culturally insensitive, because, like, we have seen anime, we know how Japanese people work. Like, we can't quite extrapolate from it, but we want to, like, desperately we want to, like, act like Japanese experts.
Let's just give the disclaimer, none of us are Japanese, we're all Americans in 2017 talking
and
about
And none of us
book.
Were born in the 40s.
Yeah, so. That's correct.
None of us majored in history.
Yeah.
Again, true.
But all that notwithstanding.
I was going to say, regardless of what little we know personally, just like the opening chapter where the Japanese save the internment camp victims, but then, like, one of the soldiers shoots someone for disrespecting the emperor, like, sets the tone of, like, okay, this is the tone of how this culture is going to end up, like, regardless of if that's super accurate or not. And I bet he did his research and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Like, it sets the tone such that the rest of the book feels consistent following that.
It is slightly kind of inconsistent to me that in the very beginning scene, there's, like, a half Japanese, half white person, and that person's already, like, a colonel or someone very serious in the army. Like, I feel that, like, pure blood Japanese in the beginning of a war would definitely have way more precedence, and you would never allow anyone of mixed breeding to have any authority. Like the Americans, like, barely even let, like, African Americans fight in, like, you know, revolutionary war times. Like, they had to form their own little group, much less have a commander status in the army. So I felt like 40 years later, there might be a half white, half Japanese person who was a colonel, like Akiko, if he wanted to make her, like, a mixed breed. But that early in the war, like, it'd be very hard to believe.
Sure. And that kind of was, you know, that you were talking before about kind of the mix of kind of management apathy or incompetence with military. Do you guys feel like that, you know, also mixes well into the, you know, into this extrapolation? Like, is that, yeah. was like, that a problem?
Like, I thought it felt like, regardless of if that's how it would happen or not, but it seems like both the, like, weird American revolutionary people as well as the Japanese culture was, like, it's kind of this hypothetical perversion of what actually happened to society. Just with, like, oh, if, you know, you nudge this way, here's, like, what horrible things could happen, regardless of if those are the horrible things that would happen.
Based on my understanding, I mean, the World War II, and this includes many of the folks who fought in it, it would be considered barbaric by today's standards of just the amount of violence that was put upon both soldiers and civilians. So, we come out of the war. It goes down to the core of how good do you think America was in 1945, kind of, because no, we were not building an empire, and yes, we were talking about American values, but I think a more sober look at U.S. history would probably argue that we certainly did many imperial-like things, imperial-ish things that may not have been in complete consistency with our values. And yet, here in 2017... we are a society, pluralistic society with a greater degree of freedom and respect for human rights. You know, would Japan have ended up the way that it's described in 1980 in this book? And to my knowledge, basically not having evolved that much, essentially, kind of a stagnation of the culture, I would say, from World War II times to 1980 as perceived in the book. I don't know if that's the case. Maybe, but... it certainly, I don't think it describes the way that things actually turned out under the alternate universe of the actual universe, the United States winning.
Yeah.
Right. So let's, you know, we touched on this a little bit too, but let's talk about how Americanism is portrayed here. You know, obviously, you know, the what's left of the Americans are the George Washingtons, and they're kind of like, you know, everyone kind of talks about, oh, those Americans, like, those were Christian people. And anytime they show up, they're Christian, they're multiracial, but they all have, like, the weird, like, American historical figure code names. And I feel like they're also pretty horrific, as, you know, they're terrorists at this point, right? So,
yeah, and that's what I was saying, where I like how it's kind of, like, more of a metaphorical perversion of values that happens in this book, rather than, like, that's how it would happen.
Yeah, I think, I definitely was not on board with the American portrayal here, but it's, you know, again, like you guys have said, they're twisted in the sense that they're barely recognizable, right?
Yeah. I mean, I think they're kind of caricatures of of like people. They don't, they lack some of the complexity of someone that you would expect in like a normal villain or good guy in a book. But like, then again, there wasn't that much time spent on them. Like Beniko and like Akiko and the rest of the main characters definitely have a lot more nuance to them. And like Martha Washington running in like Rambo with like double machine guns and stuff like that. It's like, okay, well, that's an angry American who's trying to kill everybody. Like, okay.
Yeah.
It seems like she's murking there, basically. Is that what you're saying?
I was going to say, like the mechs, they're more just part of like, this is the world that they, that these characters have to deal with and live in.
I will say, I was very disappointed that there was no Tequila Gundam or some of the other classic Gundams from the Gundam series. I was expecting the Mexican Tequila Gundam, which is not made up by me. It exists in real life, kind of, but okay. I'm trying not to be racist, but his name was Tequila Gundam.
On one hand, like the mechs seem like pretty standard military weapons, no like crazy space flights or something like that, but they did have giant electro swords, right?
They did have giant swords, yes.
Yeah, you need swords if you're going to have a Japanese mecha.
All right, so let's switch gears and talk about A-bombs in this universe. So,
you mean atomic torpedoes?
Yeah, the torpedoes. So instead of bombing like the U.S. did in the war, they're atomic torpedoes. And, you know, talking about the fallout of, no pun intended, of the use of atomic weapons there, you know, like we're all from California, from the San Jose area, and that area gets nuked in this universe. And I read that and I was like, oh, that's
Thomas is like, cool. My property value.
I know. Hey, I'm more like, I could afford a house now.
It's just really radioactive. So, I mean, man, so they talk about, you know, it's affecting fertility on, you know, on Japanese and the emperor and stuff like that. What are your guys' reactions to this?
My first reaction to like massive scales of nuking was, one, I couldn't remember exactly how many nukes were launched, but I was like convinced that if you launched enough nukes to the, and you had that much nuclear technology, the world might have ended. We might not have made it to the 80s, given the amount of nuclear like usage I think this war had in this book. Like, I looked it up and there was actually a paper published. It said basically, even if you had a small regional nuclear war, if you hit like 100 targets, like with nuclear weapons, it would cause enough fallout to cover the world for 25 years, and there would be no crops, there would be no sunlight, there would be no nothing, and basically civilization would die. I don't think they did.
I think it was over five. It was like 5 to 7 or something like that.
I forget how many it was, but it was like, yeah.
It was something like, I couldn't tell, and I was like, I think it's okay, like how many he used, but at the same time, it was way more than I think happened historically when the U.S. had nukes, but I couldn't remember exactly how many got launched. I just knew that there were torpedoes, plural, and I was like, whoa, that's a lot of nukes, I think.
So, John, do you have any input on this?
I mean, to keep it in perspective, the worldwide, we probably tested over, you know, at least over 1,000, probably over 2,000 nuclear devices of varying yield and varying amounts of... So, clearly, there's another factor here involved other than just number of atomic weapons. Otherwise, we'd be just like covered in radiation, I assume.
Well, yeah, I mean, testing is one thing, and then like actual deployment over like atmospheric conditions is like different.
I don't know. A lot of these are above ground. A lot of these are open air yield tests. They're not necessarily underground. Although, yes, right now you couldn't by international law.
So the one thing I did like about the atomic energy, and they're like, look at us in our electric cars and all our stuff, and the Germans are still using fossil fuels, but yeah, they're going
some kind of peasants.
Yeah. What was the name of the town? Hitler Town? I was like, what the hell is going on with the naming conventions in Germany?
I was going to say, was New York renamed New Hitlerton or something like that? Because our New York had a different name.
I was like, man, get some creativity, Germans.
That's where, you know, I think the author did a good job, is you immediately, like, just seeing the name New Hitlerton on the East Coast, you're just like, oh, they took over New York and renamed it after Hitler. And like, you just kind of have all this background in your head, regardless of if that's what the author intended. But he just like sneaks it all in there without having like a giant text dump of like, this is what happened to the world.
Yeah. I felt like New Munich might have been better than New Hitlertown, like in terms of subtlety.
Do you know what fascism is and how it works? Subtlety is not the name of the game.
We're also talking about a book where the mechs have giant electric swords. So,
yeah.
So I wanted to go back to the original. So that you guys were talking about, you know, what does it mean San Jose being hit by a nuke? First of all, it didn't make a lot of sense to me because they said that they had nuclear torpedoes and it's inland. So unless they hit Santa Cruz and it's a really big bomb, it didn't make a lot of sense to me. But also, I kind of felt like it was an artifact, essentially, of the author and of today. Because San Jose today is,
San Jose
Silicon
had
Valley. It's like a tech capital, right? But what was it in 1945?
Oh, yeah.
I was going to say, what's the military base? What, the thing that used to be military base that's right around here?
NASA?
Yeah. Yeah, but like that straight up was a military base, I think so. But
to use like, a nuke on it is like different from like Washington, D.C. or like some other major kind of...
Well, yeah, but I mean, the point is to like destroy a populated area.
If you were going to destroy a populated area, I would have... There would have been more important targets than San Jose. I don't think it was strategically important. Between 1945 and 1949.
Did we nuke the most, like, when the U.S. nuked Japan, was it the most, like, militarily?
It was definitely a huge population. It was more like...
Yeah.
I think we're doing for a wow factor.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, you're thinking it was sort of the officers maybe trying to draw a parallel between...
Yeah, I was thinking US it was supposed to be, like, a direct parallel where it's, like, the same type of scale or military value or that type of thing.
That's interesting. I hadn't thought of that. I mean, maybe. Maybe it would be interesting to look at... Maybe the author did look at...
Or you could take the twisted view. He did go to UC Berkeley, and maybe someone he really didn't like lived in San Jose, and he was like, screw that town! I'm nuking it in my book. I'm making Peter Dutt sound out like a terrible guy. Like, they stole my video game! I'm gonna get them! Oh, they live in San Jose! I'm nuke them!
So then he's like, and then Berkeley became the coolest military school ever.
Yeah. Actually, I think that did happen.
That did happen.
Yeah, Berkeley was the coolest military school.
So I was thinking that San Jose made a good target because it wiped away, essentially, any influence from today's timeline on tech. Which, you know, if you assume that a lot of tech came from Silicon Valley and it's so influential, then you could just basically say, nope, had no effect on, the future events and technology expansion in this new paradigm. Because it's totally uninvolved. It's gone.
Yep. All right, so we're running a little low on time, so let's go to your final thoughts. I'll start off. I loved it as an alternate history thing. Nico kind of rubbed me the wrong way most of the novel just because of his attitude. I mean, and the plot does redeem it for him a little bit at the end there, but overall, super cool to see the alternate history, weird tech, and stuff like that appear there. So, Vincent, what did you think?
So, to quote the mortal words of Staros, I think there was a lot of high techa, a few mechas, a little far fetcha, but should you read it? You betcha.
Oh, I like it. Oh. Charlie, what do you think?
I like the book. I feel like, I think I talked to you about this earlier, like my one thing about this book is I think since Forever War, it's the first book where I didn't know pretty much exactly where it was going. And in a good way. So even though, there might be issues where the characters aren't like super heroic or stuff like that, like I enjoyed it.
Enjoying it was good. How about you, John?
I thought the characters didn't bother me. I thought the characters had enough believability, enough humanity. I thought the writing style was really good. There's a timeline effect where certain parts chronologically are not revealed in the book. So it's not completely linear chronologically. I kind of like that. Kind of saves some. It saves some stuff for the end, but I mean, I got to put it out there for anybody who's taken my recommendations from this podcast. This book, if it was an motion picture, it would be rated like NC-17. this book is just horrendously violent, and I found myself almost sick reading some of the parts, like physically sick reading some of the parts because the author spares little detail in his depiction. So I think. It's really, prepare yourself for a really graphic read in terms of just the amount of violence that's in the book. But otherwise, the book had a lot of surprises. I think there's stuff to like there.
Great. So that about does it for this episode. And of course, as usual, if you have feedback or suggestions on books we should read and discuss, you can reach us at subplotofcoursepodcast@gmail.com or on Twitter at subplotpodcast. And for next month's episode, we're going to be talking about Dirk Gently's Holistic Detective Agency by Douglas Adams. Should be very exciting. Say goodbye, everybody.
Goodbye, everybody.
Goodbye, everybody.
Sayonara.